Super.
Welcome to today's webinar presented by the College Music Society, the fourth in our regular series for this academic year. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to MC today's presentation by Dr. Christine Guptill, entitled Sound Performers Canada, Impact of an Online Curriculum for College Music Student Health. Dr. Christine Guptill returns to CMS webinars today. We last saw her in early 2019 during her webinar presentation related to student musicians' injuries. She serves as assistant professor in occupational therapy at the University of Ottawa and is vice chair of research for the Performing Arts Medicine Association. She holds a Bachelor of Music degree in oboe performance, a Bachelor of Science in biology, and a PhD in rehabilitation sciences, all from Western University in London, Ontario, Canada, and a Master of Science degree in Occupational Therapy from Western Michigan University. Her program of research focuses on musicians' health from a work disability prevention perspective. Christine designed and taught the first university credit course to address musicians' health in Canada, a research study from which is the focus of today's presentation. I see that we have nearly 30 colleagues registered for this webinar from all over the US, Canada, and abroad. Today, I'm broadcasting from Azusa, California, where I'm attending the College Music Society Southwest Conference, and Dr. Guptill is in Ottawa, Ontario, Canada. We're also recording this webinar for later viewing via the College Music Society's online archives. Christine, welcome back to CMS Webinars.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here. So shall I go ahead and get started then?
Sure, please.
Okay. We were just discussing, I'm going to share my my PowerPoint for the moment, but I'm actually going to share my desktop just because I want to skip back to something that I hadn't actually thought to include. And then Bill asked me a question. I thought, you know, I should include that. So welcome everyone. Thanks for joining us, whether you're here live or whether you're joining us on the recording. It's great to be back at College Music Society, and I really appreciate your interest in this topic. So I'm going to talk to you today about a multi-year study that we actually are still analyzing some of the data from, and I am speaking to you from home today, so I just want to apologize for the occasional eye glances. Bill's already met my kitten, who has been a bit unwell and is very precocious today, so she's obviously feeling well, but she may decide to interrupt us at a couple of occasions, so hopefully she won't be too disruptive. So Sound Performers Canada is the name of this multi-year project, and we received Social Science and Humanities Research Council funding for this part of the project, and I'll explain how it fits into the whole grand scheme of the work that we've done a little bit later. And so this particular study was looking at testing an online course that's been developed by my colleagues Susie Wiseman and Bronwyn Ackerman in Australia. It's about a 13-hour course. I'll explain that a little bit more too. And it was designed to sort of help them with the fact that they were being asked to provide music education for more institutions than they could actually spread themselves out in, became a big piece to bite off, I suppose, probably more challenging than they thought it might have been at the beginning. And it's a great piece of work. So I'll tell you a little bit more about it. And when we talked about how we wanted to test it, I already had a course that I'll talk to you about in a minute that was face-to-face on musicians' health, like many of us, I think, do have created for our own institutions. And we decided that we would test them compared to each other so that we would deliver sound performers by itself to some people, and then we would embed sound performers in a face-to-face course as well. So we're calling that the blended learning portion. And I know that the terminology of these things is really kind of shifting and changing as we've moved into online learning. So that's what we meant by blended learning, was there was a face-to-face component and an online component as well. So the Sound Performers Online course was developed with support from the Australian Learning and Teaching Council grant. As I mentioned, it takes about 13 hours to complete. It has a variety of topics that it covers. So there is the topic, the body, which includes hearing. There is a topic on posture and ergonomics, on epidemiology and risk, on movement, on mental health, and on fitness. And there are built-in video clips and quizzes and resource sheets all built in to this course, which is delivered on the Moodle platform. You can actually register for the Sound Performers online course. If you just Google Sound Performers, you'll find it, and you can pay for it. I think I checked yesterday, it was about $50 Australian as an independent person to take it. And the institutional subscription, if I recall correctly, is about $1,200. So it's quite a bargain if you think about it, especially if you're at a larger university. So this is the landing page of the Sound Performers online course. And yeah, so as you can see, you can register for it or you can log in. So when we decided to do this study, we also capitalized on the fact that Sound Performers was already on Moodle, and we mounted all of our surveys on this platform. So I'll explain more about that in a bit. So this is what it looks like. And actually, I chose the piano image, but there's a couple of images that pass in the background. So a variety of us who kind of knew each other in a variety of different professional ways, with the guidance of Dr. Susie Wiseman from University of Western Australia, who's a cello prof, came together to create this Worldwide Universities Network collaboration. There were some things that we wanted to do, and as I was sort of discussing with Bill, and those of you who are academics, you know how this is. You sort of have a grand idea that you want to do, but the best way to get money for that is to start small. And so we started with an institutional grant that Susie had applied for at University of Western Australia. And then we accessed the Worldwide Universities Network for more funding. And once we had those two pieces, other people started to see that this was actually a valid idea, and then we got more and more funding. So the WUN was really important because it allowed us, a group of researchers, eight kind of core researchers and a few other people that we've added over time or who have come for just a portion of it, to get together twice. And the first time we got together was in Perth, Australia. And actually I'm thinking three times. In fact, the first time we got together was in Alberta, and that was just with the internal funding. And so we were at University of Alberta, and then we traveled south to the University of Lethbridge, where Peter Visentine is a professor at the School of Music there. And then we got together twice more. So once in Perth and once at the University of Maastricht in the Netherlands. And we were able to spend a whole week devoting ourselves to this research project, which is just invaluable. As you know, you need that face-to-face time, and in COVID times, we are missing it for sure. So out of that collaboration came this first paper, which is a report of how the collaboration kind of evolved and what happened and what we did and what our research goals are. And you can see the names of the core group of researchers here. And that is published in the journal Medical Problems of Performing Artists, if you're interested in looking that up. So one of the goals of our collaboration, we felt that it was really important to address the knowledge that students had about musicians' health. And as Susie did a lot more research and kind of thinking about how to hang this together, this is how the WUN collaboration came about. The more she looked, the more she was really intrigued by the notion of health literacy. And health literacy was a pretty hot topic at that point. It had been kind of worked on for the previous maybe 6 or 7 years before we first got together in 2017. There probably are people, of course, who worked on it much longer than that, but it was really gaining a lot of publication attention at that stage. And she felt that health literacy was really the key to helping our students to understand what the risks might be and to take the action that they needed to take to support their own health and well-being. And so we started to talk about, could we address health literacy by developing a tool to measure it so that we could measure the outcomes of our research? And so thus we embarked upon a part of this study. So this was a piece of the Sound Performers Canada that I think helped us to get some funding from the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council as well. So here's a definition of health literacy. So this is from the Health Literacy Survey Europe Consortium. And their tools are probably the most widely used and well-known. There are other tools, but their set of questionnaires are probably the best known. So their definition of health literacy is the knowledge, motivation, and competence to access, understand, appraise, and apply health information in order to make judgments and take decisions in everyday life concerning healthcare, disease prevention, and health promotion to maintain or improve quality of life throughout the course of life. So it's lots. There's a big mouthful in there. But I would say those access, understand, appraise, and apply are important words. And then also the domains of healthcare, disease prevention, and health promotion. You're going to see those come up again. So people with low health literacy are more likely to visit an emergency room. They have more hospital stays. They're less likely to follow treatment plans, and they have higher mortality rates. And so this is why health literacy became a big concern, and tools to evaluate it were very, very popular and still are. So we know that in some vulnerable groups, health literacy is lower. And so those vulnerable groups include folks with lower levels of education, who are older and sometimes younger, have different social status. There's some question around the social status piece, then financial deprivation and chronic conditions. And I've bolded those last two because really when we're talking about student musicians, we need to keep in mind that many student musicians don't have a ton of disposable income. And so that's an important factor. And most musician injuries or health concerns, let's say, we could choose a lot of different terms, tend to be more chronic. So once musicians encounter a problem related to health that has a relationship with their performing, they tend to stick around for their career and they kind of re-encounter that problem over and over again. Even if they've kind of gotten it under control, it may kind of reemerge. So we already knew we were dealing with a vulnerable group in terms of health literacy, and that helped to justify it a little bit more. So what I'm showing you here, this is actually the questionnaire that we designed. And so I'm going to talk a little bit more about how it was developed, but I want to show it to you so that you have a sense of where we're going with this. So the basic question, and this is it's very similar to the health literacy survey from Europe, the HLS EU tools, in the sense that the question starts the same way. So on a scale from very easy to very difficult, how easy would you say it is to, and then the individual questions. And that scale, the 1, 2, 3, 4, from very difficult to very easy is the same. And then the number 5 is a don't know. I'm not sure if you guys can see that under my little, I can move myself, and I'm not sure if you can see it. So the last column is don't know. And so you can see some of the questions in the questionnaire, and they go from, I would say, perhaps relatively simple questions like how easy or difficult would you say it is to find reliable advice for your performance health, to relatively kind of complex questions where there's a compound issue. So follow treatment advice if you have performance health issues. I'll tell you why that became an issue later on. So the paper that hopefully will be submitted very shortly about the development of this tool, we're sort of in the final throes of editing for that manuscript, is called The Development of the Musician's Health Literacy Questionnaire, and it's going to be submitted to Health Promotion International very shortly. And then that manuscript has been in the works for a long time. Obviously, we had developed it some time ago, but the next step was to validate the tool. And so when we talk about tool validation for questionnaires, we're talking primarily about measuring validity and reliability of the tool. So I just want to show you a little bit of the data that there is a paper that hopefully we will be submitting on Monday. So they're very close to each other about the tool validation so that you'll have a little bit more information if that's of interest to you. What I'm showing you right now is some of the raw data in regards to validity. So one of the ways to do tool validation with a questionnaire like this is to compare it to other tools. And if you've got a construct that other people have measured or considered, then typically you would put it, you would sort of do a battery of surveys where you would put it with other tools that you knew measured the same construct. The tricky part with what we were doing was we had developed a tool to measure kind of a construct that hadn't really been measured before. We felt that it was a subset of health literacy. So generally health literacy questionnaires, it's not always true because there are some that are very specific, but generally they're quite general and they consider health literacy to be a broad construct that applies to a whole population. There are a few exceptions to that. There are a few tools that are for specific populations, and that's what we've done here. So we expected there to be some overlap with a general health literacy tool. And then we also looked at some other constructs that we thought would be related, like self-efficacy, for example, and also with other measures of musicians' health that we thought were relevant. But we never expected them to completely overlap, and they don't. So it's a little bit more difficult than some other validation studies in terms of we can't say it's exactly the same, nor did we want to. And so the results are a little bit more subjective, perhaps, is maybe the word. So if you can see this graph here showing us that there is a moderate correlation between our survey, which is the Musicians' Health Literacy Q19, and the original European survey, the HLS EU Q16. So you can see they do overlap. It's a moderate relationship. It's nothing really strong, nothing really weak. That's as we expected it to be. We actually had predicted a weak relationship. This is slightly stronger than that. So what that sort of means is that on the Venn diagram, if you were looking at health literacy as a thing that we know about, you've got kind of general health literacy, and it's overlapping with musicians' health literacy, but they're not the same. When we look at correlations with the musicians, I'm going to always forget what this acronym is, but MPI-IQM is a measure of interference and intensity of pain in musicians. And so you can see that they do correlate, but it's a slightly negative correlation. And that was somewhat what we had predicted as well. And I'll explain that in a minute. And then here is the correlation with the pain intensity score. So the previous was pain interference. This is pain intensity. And then this is the general self-efficacy scale. So you can see that musicians' health literacy and self-efficacy are weakly related. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about that. So we had hypotheses about these. Our hypothesis 1 and 3 were confirmed in terms of the relationship with the original health literacy tool and with the self-efficacy tool, although the relationship with the self-efficacy tool was a little bit lower than our hypothesis. And our hypothesis 2, we had actually hypothesized that folks with more interference and pain, so more injuries, if you will, would be more inclined to seek out information and thus have higher health literacy. That's not what happened. What happened, in fact, is that there's a slightly negative relationship. So we're now sort of starting to contemplate whether difficulty finding, appraising, and applying information, in fact, sort of made people have lower health literacy, so that if they were frustrated or not able to find the resources that they wanted, that might explain why their health literacy was lower if they had more symptoms. This is just a fancy table to show you that the reliability of the test is decent. It's a little bit lower than we would have liked. We used test retest reliability, so the students received the questionnaire 1 week, and then 2 weeks later they received it again. And so we would have expected those answers to be relatively stable over time. So there are 3 possibilities when that happens. One is that the construct itself isn't stable. Another is that the responses are not stable. And the third, sorry, that's a typo, it should say responses are not stable, not responses are stable. The third is that it might be that people who are responding to the questionnaire, you know, that the construct has changed in their mind. So that responding to the questionnaire itself changes the construct for the respondent. So that's kind of an intriguing idea. So what that means is perhaps for music students that thinking about health literacy, particularly if you don't think that what's going on with you is about health, might actually change your literacy. And there's a little bit of literature there's a little bit of research in the literature that suggests to us that musicians don't think of things that healthcare workers like me might identify as a health problem as being a health problem. So we see that some students or musicians in general might think that their problem is more a pedagogical problem or more a problem with them, something that they've done that's caused these symptoms. Maybe they just need to go into the practice room and practice more, for example. And in healthcare, those of us who are alert to these things don't necessarily feel that that's the case. And so this is kind of an intriguing question for future research. So just to show you the last little piece that I want to give you about the validation study, this is actually the domains, the health literacy matrix that was designed by the designers of the European Health Literacy Questionnaire set. And so you can see that on that left-hand column, healthcare, disease prevention, and health promotion. And when we did a factor analysis on the responses to our questionnaire, we found that they fell into three categories quite nicely, and they lined up not too badly with those three factors and how we had designed our questions. However, clearly the respondents thought somewhat differently about some of the questions than we did. So if I skip back and show you, I'm going to show you the questions themselves again. So question 19, 18 and 19, which are the two bottom ones. So understand treatment advice if you have performance health issues, and follow treatment advice if you have performance health issues. We thought those were questions about healthcare. Our respondents didn't agree with us, and they lumped them into the same category as questions that we had labeled disease prevention. Now, that doesn't mean that they thought they were about disease prevention, because remember, the respondents don't know what categories we've put these in. These just came from the European health literacy tool. But we thought that was very interesting. So we've sort of tentatively renamed that category rather than disease prevention, because disease prevention doesn't really fit with the kinds of questions we asked anyway. But along the lines of, if you look at this row that disease prevention is in, things like ability to access information on risk factors. So you see risk factors showing up a lot. And so we actually renamed that category risk factors for performance health. So this is just to show you how they landed. So if you look at the lumping, that first lumping together in disease prevention, you can see there are other questions that are sort of about risk, risks to performance health. Whoops. Okay, so just to kind of summarize what I just said, so most of the questions loaded into a pattern that reflected the three domains of the HLSMU tool. Question 18 and 19 also loaded on disease prevention. And when we read all that together, we felt that participants didn't actually see disease prevention. So we've renamed it tentatively to risks to performance health. We'll see if that makes it into the manuscript on Monday. So I just want to pause here for a second, and I'm going to share something different with you. Because what Bill had asked me about was about the course itself. And so I've talked to you a bit about sound performers, but the face-to-face course was based on a course that I developed when I was in my PhD. And the locations, we had three sites. We did this test at University of Alberta, at University of Toronto, and at University of Lethbridge. And at Lethbridge, I basically gave this course outline to my friend Peter Byzantine, and Peter has changed it somewhat. But the topics are fairly similar. And so if you look at some of the topics that are covered in that face-to-face course, you'll see vocal health, you'll see somatic techniques. At the time, we had Dr. Judy Pallett come and give us a lecture, which was fantastic. You'll see emotional well-being and music performance, achieving musical excellence, so cognitive and physical strategies to do that. You'll see vocal health. You'll see musculoskeletal injuries. You'll see prevention and treatment of hearing loss, ergonomics and biomechanics, neurological impairments, lifespan approaches, health and music performance across the lifespan, and then a lecture on social determinants of health. And finally, health promotion in music education and performance. So it's quite a broad-ranging course, and it's somewhat different than the topics that were covered in the sound performers course. So we felt that they complemented each other. And generally the way that it was done is that the first hour of class, because it's 13 hours, so that's sort of a third, right? So the first hour of class was devoted to sound performers. And sometimes the students would work in the same room with Peter, and sometimes they would work on their own. And then the next 2 hours were devoted to the topic of the day and going through some of the readings and any questions the students had about sound performers. So effectively, they sort of did sound performers at their own pace as they went through, although there were some ways to integrate that into the class. And then they had the face-to-face course as well for a place for discussion and challenging some thoughts. And then they did two major assignments, and Peter has added on a poster presentation to their assignments as well. So how did we test this? So we pulled together a bunch of questionnaires, and the students at the very beginning, before they started the course, I'll back up and say that at University of Toronto and University of Alberta, there was no course structure to this. So we offered sound performers to anyone who wanted to take it. Unfortunately, because of ethics, we weren't allowed to require the students to take it. That would be nice if we could. So it was really on a volunteer basis. And that will really impact the results. I'll talk to you about that in a minute. But Lethbridge, we had the course, and then people could take sound performers on its own as well. They were welcome to do that. And it was for free at all three institutions. So at the very beginning of the semester, we sent out this survey for people who were interested in either taking it voluntarily or were registered in Peter's course. And they would complete this battery of surveys. So that includes the RAND-12, which is, if you've heard of the SF tools, that's the same questionnaire. It's just the version that doesn't require a license to analyze it. The depression, anxiety, and stress scale, the MPI-IQM again, the Kenny Music Performance Anxiety Inventory revised, our new health literacy tool, and then some self-reported health behaviors. And we took the literature and basically asked them some questions about how important they thought particular health behaviors were and what their kind of current practice was. So, you know, the usual things like smoking and drinking and getting enough exercise and eating a balanced diet, but then also some that were specifically related to musicians' health, like, do you warm up before you practice? Do you do stretching? And I say that very cautiously because we don't have a ton of literature talking about the benefits of stretching, but I knew that a lot of musicians did use stretching as a preventive, and I was quite interested in that. Do you take measures to protect your hearing? Those are the kinds of things we asked. So you can see here, these were the universities that were involved. We did have a couple of other studies running at the same time with sound performers, and we fear a little bit that that tiny little blip of unknown were some students who found their way into the Sound Performers Canada study, but were meant to be doing a survey elsewhere. So that does happen. This is who answered the survey. We have actually since then done some work on better design for questionnaires to identify gender, understanding that it's a social construct and that the binary divide is no longer really comprehensive in modern society. That's just not who we are anymore. And so we do a much better job than we did at the time of measuring this, I think. We do a better job. And we should. Participants' principal instruments. You can see here we had a large number of voice folks joining us in the study. The woodwind is fun. We think that there was a saxophone professor at one of the universities who was telling all their students about it, because we had lots of saxophone players in the sample. Right, and so I'm not going to talk too much about the quantitative data there, just to say that unfortunately we weren't able over the course of the course itself to show a reduction in actual injuries or health outcomes. We didn't have really, in my mind, we didn't have enough people participating. And that I think is in itself a really important conclusion, because we know that if we make a particular educational effort mandatory for students, or if we give them credit for it, or if we give them a grade, that they're much more likely to engage in it than if we don't, right? And so what we found was that where it was offered as an option, 13 hours is a lot to ask of students to kind of give of their own free time. And many of them were fairly keen at the beginning, and then they would just drop out. So really one of the conclusions we can draw from that is that unless it's offered in the context of a curriculum, a course, some sort of mandatory thing you have to do for your degree, students just aren't going to do it. And that was an important conclusion for us to find, in fact. And it's interesting that when it was first launched, sound performers at University of Western Australia, it was optional. And over time, the school decided to make it mandatory. And so it isn't in the context of a course, although it is sort of tied to studio teaching. The students have to complete it before they graduate. And the timeline is, you know, quite variable. They're sort of allowed to take as much time as they want, and their own studio teachers are given as a primary resource for it, but it isn't a course itself. So the other thing that we did, because we knew that this was potentially an outcome, that we weren't going to have a lot of statistics to share with folks, was we did focus groups. And so we asked people at the beginning of them signing up for the course, would you be willing to participate in a focus group? And we did those focus groups twice throughout the course. So once kind of midway, and then once when the course was finished. And we did those focus groups at the different locations. And in some cases, when we didn't have enough participants to actually have a full focus groups, we did individual interviews with people. And so over the period, we got more focus group participation from University of Lethbridge where the course was being offered, but we did have participants at each of the other institutions as well. So this is just a sampling of some of the findings from that. So we've got a fourth year voice major here telling us, it's made me a lot more aware, this is the course, it's made me a lot more aware in my rehearsing and practicing, I think. That information has helped to reiterate and really confirm. I didn't realize the lack of information I had until getting in here in the course. Personally, I recommend it to anybody that I talk to, because I think it's something that being aware of yourself and what you're doing and how you're doing it is important to every aspect of your life, like your everyday existence. And especially as a musician, like we don't really get talked to a lot about it before. So I think it's really, really useful. I really enjoy it. And then if we look at this fourth year instrumentalist, the person said, what you said about the anxiety, I've experienced that so badly. My teacher approached it. She was like, oh, well, you're only nervous because you must not feel like you're prepared enough. So you really need to practice more. Well, that's not actually the best way to go, but that doesn't help. And then we can look at, some other quotes. So a fourth year instrumentalist again, different person. Nobody ever tells you about it until after you're already experiencing symptoms or are injured. All the information I received before that, everybody was like, yeah, you need to have good posture. And I'm like, great, what's that? And then a fourth year kinesiology student, this is to remind me to tell you that some of the students registered in Peter's course were not music students. And we did that quite deliberately. We really wanted to kind of foster an interdisciplinary exchange where the students could learn from each other. And so in some cases, I would say that the music students gained a little bit more knowledge about how to sort of appraise the scientific literature. They definitely did. Peter is very good at that. And I would say that some of the other areas that students came from learned a lot more about the demands on professional musicians and music students. So this fourth year kinesiology student said, I think that the online course should definitely be mandatory in first year. And they meant first year music school, because it gives you like a broad range of all the information. And then you can do your own research if you really want to focus on some portion of it. That person, wouldn't surprise you, went on to graduate studies. So in summary, we're talking about here a four-part study to determine the most fruitful kind of research avenues. And we created a health literacy tool for musicians, and the validation study will probably be submitted on Monday. And the uptake of the voluntary course was not great, and that wasn't unexpected. But we did get some very rich qualitative data that tells us how music students are responding to courses like this. So our big question is, can we eventually do this in such a way that we'd be able to see whether health and behaviors change over time with this type of education? So stay tuned, we have more up our sleeve where that came from. So thanks so much for your attention today. And I want to just open the floor to your questions. And just realizing that some of these slides are from an older presentation and I didn't change my email address. So I'm gonna do it while we talk, but thank you for your time.
Christine, thanks so much. Really, really interesting study. And I appreciate the way you've presented it to us. I think a lot of people will use it not only as data for themselves, but also perhaps as to stimulate conversation about using a tool within their program. So I appreciate that. I would encourage the listeners, we've got time for some questions if people want to post that either in the Q&A or the chat. Christine, I'll start. I think in the States, in the US, I think a lot of us, because of the data we've been seeing from COVID in terms of marginalized populations and showing possibilities, some correlation of bias from healthcare itself, I think a lot of us would look at this and wonder if we might adapt, if we take this your tool and adapt it, that we would get demographic information about race as well, because I think that's a big issue for a lot of us in our programs, and we suspect that if we don't have the data specifically, we suspect that our students of color are themselves an at-risk group, just if we extrapolate from the data that we're getting from larger COVID studies and the like. And I'm curious if your research team has talked about that for a next level, especially if you have a larger sample.
I think it's a great question. It's not one that we integrated into the validation study for the tool, to be honest. We certainly did recruit from all over the world, however. So we did look a little bit about at geographic location of the study. So we did have a sample, for example, from South Africa. So we looked at geographic location and we didn't see any trends. But that's not to say that, you know, doing it again and looking and asking the right questions might come up with something different. I suspect you're probably right. We certainly know that health literacy in other areas, health literacy is lower based on a lot of the, you know, the kind of social factors that we know are important in determining people's health, right? So any social determinants of health tend to fall out along divisions of identity for a variety of different things. And so I would suspect we probably would find the same thing. So it's probably important for us to continue to do that. So this was the first validation study, and we certainly will continue to do more with students, but also more with professionals. And I didn't say this, but we actually excluded singers from this validation study. And the only reason we did is because the MPI IQM has never been validated on singers. But that's actually one of the next steps we want to do, is to share this with some singers and see if there's any big differences or similarities. We suspect there will be kind of a number of similarities, because we're just looking at the health literacy piece, right? We're not necessarily looking at anything to do with performance criteria or anything, or even physical symptoms. So I suspect it would be similar, but we didn't want to muck up the first attempt at validation by introducing a new variable. So yeah, as a qualitative researcher, I sort of feel a bit icky about that. But yes, you know, validation has its methods, and so we'll continue to go from there. But yes, thank you. It's a really important question.
It's a great start, obviously, and we didn't have anything like this 15 years ago, for sure. So that's where we're headed. I think, especially if I understood your explanation of the negative correlation, the data that showed a negative correlation, that might speak to a population that has traditionally felt excluded from good healthcare. So they're less likely then to have an enthusiasm to develop literacy about it, because it's not been available or been available with inequities in it anyway.
Absolutely. No, I think you're absolutely right. And I think it also really speaks to, you know, the notion that if you're internalizing the cause, right? If your immediate response to "I'm having pain from, say, playing the piano" is to internalize it and think, "Oh, it must just be that I'm not practicing enough, or I'm not fit enough, or I'm not following my teacher's instructions well enough," mm-hmm. you're not going to go seek out healthcare for that. And so this is why we were so intrigued by some of those negative relationships, and then some of the other findings that just sort of started to suggest to us that, for instance, in those 2 weeks, right, is it possible that the fact that we now asked you about health literacy in that context, and now you're putting the puzzle pieces together and thinking, wait a minute, maybe that wrist problem I'm having isn't just because it's me, then maybe you're starting to seek out information, and all of a sudden you're more interested and more engaged, and your health literacy score goes up. So this is sort of where we're thinking at this point. Lots more to do, though.
That speaks to those of us in academia who believe that a test can actually teach students something. And
indeed.
So they learned from the test, and now they have different attitudes or different, maybe they even want to investigate some things. Yeah, it seems like a very, very likely, especially with young people who have maybe never encountered some of these kinds of questions.
Well, this is it. And my PhD student was the one who immediately said, well, that sort of bodes well. I mean, if it's as easy as giving them a questionnaire to teach them about this stuff, then boy, our job's going to be really easy. That remains to be seen. We'll see if that actually pans out. But yes, indeed.
And it also suggests a methodology for working with our students. I think a lot of us have developed, a lot of our programs have developed resource information, you know, websites and links and all that sort of stuff for students to seek out. But perhaps something a little bit more direct, engaging with them to probe their abilities, ideas, exposures, and, you know, those sorts of things. Not just a kind of passive, well, here's the information, if you need it, come get it. Yeah,
indeed. Yeah, stay tuned for that paper too, because there were some results that spoke to me on that line. That, and I'm trying to think of exactly what it was, but I remember writing a couple of days ago that this part of this suggested to me that simply telling people that it was important and then expecting them to do something about it wasn't going to. It's the self-efficacy piece. Yeah. So if self-efficacy is only weakly related to health literacy, then people clearly don't feel that they can do something about it, right? And so that sort of suggests that just handing them the tools and saying, go to, is not going to work very well, right? So that does imply what you're suggesting, I think, which is a more active engagement of we actually have to take this on. And in my mind, and this is not about this study at all, this is about the next piece that comes along. In my mind, there's a huge impact of the whole institutional environment and the culture of a music school in kind of teaching the students through example and through the whole social environment that this is important and you need to value your own well-being. And that is something I think that's coming with time. As time goes by and we all become more aware of this and papers get published about it and NASM implements requirements for us to offer these things in the schools, you know, as that's changing, I think that students are becoming more aware and are taking better care of themselves. And especially in the arena of mental health, of course, for other reasons entirely, not to do with the fact that we've all been researching musicians' health for a couple of decades, you know, mental health has become a really important topic in schools in general. And that's great. And that hopefully benefits everyone.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned NASM. I think it'd be very interesting to see if the conversation your findings about this, the powerful nature of the tool itself, if it might lead to some guidelines that change, not just about providing information, but actually words about engaging students in conversations about health. It seems so subtle, but I think it's a really powerful. Some powerful findings that I think you're going to explicate for our population. So thanks. I think that's really, really, really interesting. I think our attendees are pondering all of the information you've provided, Christine, and I really, really appreciate you providing this your narrative of this research project and the implications it has for our programs. A really, really, really great addition to our archive. I think I'm going to have to bring us to an official close. So to our attendees, I hope you've enjoyed this College Music Society webinar. I'm sure you found it professionally informative. In the next days, webinar attendees should receive email confirmation of your attendance. Please feel free to use the comment option in that email to provide feedback about the series and our format. I hope you'll return for future webinars from the College Music Society, including our next cultural inclusion workshop, a focus on inclusive pedagogy, creating course content and activities that acknowledge the cultural capital of our students in the music education class. And that's scheduled for Sunday, March 13. Our next Musicians Health session, which will be broadcast on Friday, March 18th, we'll feature Dr. Dana Glazenhart, and her talk is entitled The Role of the Audiologist in Helping Musicians. And now on behalf of all of us at the College Music Society, I want to thank Dr. Christine Guptill for her presentation and all of our listeners for attending. Please accept our best wishes for today and the upcoming weeks. I'll see you back here next month.